was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the
Your name is victory. Just making sure the mic's working. I know what I'm doing, I promise, some days. It is always, the last few weeks has been like just so fun to get online and hear from all of you, all the people I don't get to see. We don't get to connect and we see you in person, but Sundays have become so special when we all get online together and we talk. And so please do it today. And welcome to church for those of you who are on right now already. But remember, send in your prayer requests, your words, the different things that you're sensing from the Lord. And let's interact and let's do church. Let's do community this morning online. Okay, guys, it's so wonderful to see it and be a part of that with you all. Grab your kids, get some time if you can. We're going to do communion together in a little bit. So go ahead and grab those elements and get them ready and pull them forward and, you know, out of your kitchen or whatever it is and bring them to wherever you're watching it and get ready. Let's do church. There are some new kid videos up on our website, you know, citylights.church, and you can go and pull the tab down and do that with your kids later. But let's get into worship, hey? Let's lift him up and let's go for it.
Darkness tries, when darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, no, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Sing shame no longer. Shame no longer has a place to hide, and I am not a captive to the lies, and I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. No, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. Cause my fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Going to do a new song this morning after this. It's called The Father's House, and I don't think there's a more perfect time to do it when none of us are in the building other than these people here. A lot of the time we sing a song like this where there's some imagery that's natural, like The Father's House, and we think of a sanctuary, or we think of a building, we think of this place. And the reality is that the house that we're singing about is our family. We're in the Father's family. And 1 John 3:1 says, how great is the love that's lavished on us that we would be called sons and daughters of God, for that is what we are. We are in his house, we're in his family, and he has us in his hands. So as we go into this, just think of it in those terms, not as a building, but as a family, and that's who we are. On this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. But my story isn't over, my story's just begun. A failure won't define me, that's what my Father does. A failure won't define me, that's what my Father does. Come home. Prodigals come home. The helpless find hope. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Prison doors fling wide. The dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Miracles take place. The cynical find faith, and love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. And Jericho walls are quaking, and strongholds now are shaking. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. So thankful that we're in your house. Darkness, my God, that is who you are. The way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. Worship you. You are here. You're healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Waiting you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Church, we're going to move into a time of communion. So if you want to gather your family around, get those communion elements out. I just want to say a couple things. So today is Palm Sunday. Is this working? Yeah, okay. We can't hear it in the house, but I guess it's going through the web stream. So Palm Sunday is an important memory for us as we move forward. Okay, we're good. Sorry, guys. Technical stuff. Palm Sunday is something we celebrate as Christians, and it is the day that had been prophesied for hundreds of years before Jesus came, that they were looking forward to a Savior, and that he would enter into Jerusalem riding on a donkey. And the day that Palm Sunday was the day that that prophecy was fulfilled. When Jesus came in, it's called the triumphant entry of Jesus into the city of Jerusalem, and it says, says that as he rode in on this donkey, that the people in Jerusalem took palm branches and they laid them down on the streets and they created this procession and they said, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest, which Hosanna means come save us. And today, how many of you know we need Hosanna? We need God, come save us in this moment. And it begins the Holy Week where we look into the most powerful part of our whole lives, which is the future telling of Good Friday, which is the night of crucifixion, when Jesus, you know, instead of having palm branches and coming as this king to be celebrated and to be worshiped in that season, Jesus didn't take his place as king. What he did was he moved into Friday, where he, instead of having the palms laid at his feet, he put his palms out and was pierced in his palms on Good Friday that very same week, because it wasn't the right way to do it, to take his place as king, until he had done once and for all what we needed, which was to pay for the penalty of the sins of the world and to bring us right with God. And so he opened his palms and he took our sin and shame, and he died. And then on next week, we're going to be celebrating Easter, which is the most powerful day that we could ever celebrate, which is the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. When he rose from the dead, he made us right with him. Sin, shame, separation were done away with, and he became the indwelling inside of our hearts through the Holy Spirit when we put our trust in Jesus. So as we take communion today, I just want you guys to think about the beauty of Jesus. And we're going to do this as an act of intercession for our world right now, that Jesus, by his stripes, we were healed, and by with his blood shed, that it was for the forgiveness and the remission of sins, making us righteous without fault, spot, or wrinkle, or blame, or accusation. We just thank you for your blood of Jesus. God, as we receive and we remember the power of what you did, God, you could have taken your place as king, but instead you laid your life down for us. And we thank you for it. We remember that humility and that honor and that sacrifice that you laid down to when the Son of God became a son of man so that the sons of men could become sons of God. We thank you for making us sons of God this morning. And God, I bless these elements, God. We pray for breakthrough with this virus, God, that this would just be that blood over our doorpost. God, the Lamb of God was slain to stop plague from our household. So God, I just declare a stop to this plague over the households, God, involved in this prayer, and whoever watches this later, God, we just say no more to that plague as we remember the power of the blood of Jesus in the broken body. So if you would, just go ahead and take communion, and we're going to receive those elements right now. So go ahead and serve them to your family or take them.
Thank you.
He is for you. In the midst of your worry or your anger or your fear or your grieving, He is for you. He is for you in the rejoicing, and He's for every generation, over and over and over again. And when we tap into Him in the midst of those emotions, in the midst of the pain, in the midst of the confusion, that's when a blessing starts flowing to the next generation, right? We won't have the opportunity to worship in pain and in confusion and in worry and in anxiety and in fear in heaven, right? Because that stuff won't exist. This is our opportunity now, in the midst of whatever we struggle with, to worship Him and to change the generations through our worship and through our prayer and through our praise. That's the foundation, right? The foundation that can't be shaken. And that's what we leave for the next generation. And we love the next generation. We love all the generations here. And so Evie actually has a word. And Emily and I this morning, I mean, she was telling me it, and we just felt the Lord on it, because there's no junior Holy Spirit, right? Our kids hear God. And so, Evie, I want you to share that, because I think it's so important for us to hear.
Thank you, Harmony. Friday morning, I woke up saying to myself, there are three things I am going to carry with myself throughout the day. One thing is my clothes, obviously. My second thing is my faith, because I need to trust God throughout the day that He is going to get rid of this plague. The third thing is a smile. It's welcoming to those who are new, and it just makes everyone feel better. The three things I am going to leave behind are, one, my fear. Number two, my weight of guilt. No one needs to carry our guilt, because God is going to make our future new. You can't change the past. You can change the future. The last thing is you can't go back into the past. You have to leave it behind. You can't go back in time and fix everything. You can change the future, but you can't change the past.
Good word. When Evie was sharing it this morning, I thought, that's so awesome. Because we can, right? We have to put on things, and it's her clothes, right? You need to, like, put on clothes. I mean, a lot of us are wearing pajamas all day long who don't have to leave. I mean, come on, just admit it. But I also was realizing that the Bible says we put on a garment of praise, right? So let's put on praise. His mercies are new every morning, and we wake up and we put on praise like we put on our clothes, right? And we grab our faith, like you're saying, right? And then we put on that smile. We say, I'm going to tap into joy. I'm going to grab joy, right? And I choose to leave the past in the past, right? I don't need to partner with it anymore. I don't need to make it bring guilt and shame and regret. I need to just let it go, right? And I'm not going to pick those things up. And so I thought that was a great word for us. And I feel like, God's speaking to all of us. He's doing something. So take that word to heart this week. Take that word to heart right now. And a few other words that came out is, God is like sifting us. You can go down if you want. God's like kind of sifting us, right? He's shaking things. And there are things that are coming to the surface. And one of those things is anger. Somebody got a word about anger. And anger is often rooted in fear, in when we don't have control. And that's what's going on right now. And so there's something that's happening where God is allowing anger to come to the surface so He can deal with it. Right? So be attentive to that and be quick to deal with it and hand it to the Lord, right? Feel it. Don't act on it, because you don't want to cause violence, right? Because fear, you know, leads to anger, which then leads to violence. And there's a lot. Domestic abuse cases are through the roof right now because people feel out of control and they get angry. They feel fearful and they get angry and then they act out on it. So we need to deal with it in our lives first and foremost so that we can then deal with it and pray for the people in our community that are under it and are being controlled by it, right? And we know we've all been in this for weeks now, but God is dealing with fear and worry. So let him deal with it. Let him get you free of it, right? Because if you can rule in the midst of your enemies when everything is chaos and fear is running rampant, then you can rule in anything. So let him deal with that fear. Let him deal with that worry and let him get you free. And someone else actually had a word that said, God is going to be bringing the prodigals home. Those ones that are struggled, those kids or those family members that are just on the fringe and are even out there fully away from God. God is going to bring them home. So let's stand on that promise. Lord, we just choose to say we let you have your way in our lives. Have your way, God. Lord, have your way. Change the things in us that are coming to the surface that aren't of you. Lord, deal with the fear, deal with the worry, deal with the anger, God. Deal with the guilt, the past, the things that have been hanging us up. Deal with those things, Lord God. We give them to you freely, and we choose these other things. We choose praise. We choose faith. We choose joy. And Lord, we thank you that as we do that in the midst of all of this, not only are we commanding a blessing for ourselves, but we are commanding a blessing for the generations. Every generation that will come through us. So we receive that and we believe through that you will do something with the prodigals and bring them home in Jesus' name.
Yeah, Evie shared that word with me on Friday and I asked her if she'd make a little video for social media and she said, no, I'll just put it in the chat room on Sunday morning. And then we felt like she should just say it because I think it's powerful when kids get to see other kids on stage and moving in their gifting. So we love that. So anyway, thank you guys for worshiping. We're going to go ahead and transition our service. We have three ways to give online. You can give online, you can text to give, or if you would like to send a check in, you can also mail a check if you go onto our website and go down to the contact us button. There's our post office box on there. We appreciate your faithfulness in giving. God has been so good. You guys have been just really faithful to give. We appreciate that. We know many of you are struggling, and we are here as a church, as a community, to partner with you, to stand with you, to bless you, to meet your needs when we can. But we also appreciate the generosity. There's a tradition, I think, in the Jewish culture that when things get really hard for them and things feel really squeezed, there's like an act of breakthrough where they give more, where they're more generous. And sometimes that can actually shift things spiritually when you're just real generous. There's something that breaks off of us, that stinginess, that fear, that... Am I on there? Yeah. That grasping and wanting to hold on to everything, that when we put our trust in Jesus, put our money in his hands, he is faithful to rebuke the devourer on your behalf. So thank you for giving. Thank you for your faithfulness. We are praying for you. I want to just let you guys know what's happening next week. We have a very, very special Easter service that we have been working on to bring you to your home. We're calling it City Lights Easter at Home. And as always, as we are doing these live stream services, we will plan on taking communion together every single week. So if you want to add that to your click list order, a little grape juice. I've been using oyster crackers here just because, I don't know, it keeps it simple. But yeah, let's plan on doing communion together on Easter. And we have a really special kids service planned where we will go live just this Sunday for Easter at 9:45. And that will be a kids service for that first 15 minutes. And then we will have some printouts you guys can print out for your kiddos on our website. And they can work on those while we do our normal church service starting at 10 a.m. We'll have some really special things. We've been working hard behind the scenes with our incredible sound and media team, worship team. A lot of our directors have little parts of the service. So we would love it if you join with us, join with your family, call your friends who don't normally go to church, tell them to tune in, because Easter Sunday is a day of resurrection. It is a day of salvation. It's a great day for people to know Jesus, and that's our focus. So please tune in with us, 9:45 kids, 10 a.m. adults. And finally, I just want to make the reminder that the outreach at citylights.church email is what you can use if you are in need and you are stuck, you can't leave, you need some tangible just necessities, things like that. Would you reach out to us? We have a team of outreach people who would love to minister to you, to meet needs emotionally, spiritually, and tangibly as well. So just shoot us an email and we'll connect with you. If you need prayer, you just email prayer@citylights.church. And if you're interested in anything else at all, you can either put it in the chat or you can email us at info@citylights.church. So please do that. I'm just going to pray for you, and then Pastor Kurt's going to come up and bring an amazing word. Jesus, thank you for your people. Thank you as they give, God, that you are faithful to provide. You are faithful. God, your word says, I have never seen the righteous forsaken or their children begging for bread. So God, I just declare that scripture over our church, over our city, our world. God, that you are a provider in the time of need. You're the God who multiplied loaves and fishes. You are faithful. So God, anyone that has struggled with job loss, income, small business, medium or large size business, Father, we just thank you that you are a provider. You are faithful. And we're just putting our trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Here is your pastor and a really good looking guy, Pastor Kurt.
So much, Emily. Well, welcome. Thank you for welcoming me, I should say, into your homes week after week. It's been great. It's kind of been great. I'm actually really excited about the day when we all get to meet here again. I just want to say before we get into the message here, thank you to behind the scenes here. You saw all the people who are on the stage, so thank you guys who were here on the stage helping out worship team and all that. But also people that are behind the scenes, like the guy behind the camera right now, Mike Simmons, thank you for helping out. We appreciate you so much. Adam Lowry and Jared Eddy back in the media department there. Russell Sickler, he's doing a separate mix out in the foyer for you guys to make sure it sounds good for you. And Kai Miniger's back there on sound. Thank you guys so much for making all this happen. There's a lot of behind the scenes that makes this happen, and we're so grateful for our media team. We would not be able to have this caliber of a presentation had it not been for our amazing media team. We're so thankful for God for those individuals. All right, as Emily said, I just want to reiterate a couple things. Happy Palm Sunday, number one, and we'll talk a little bit more about that here in just a minute. But also, again, next week, Resurrection Sunday. It's going to be amazing. And just if you missed it, we're going to have a kids' service start at 9:45. If you tune in at citylights.church, kids' service will kick off 9:45, and then our regular service, worship with everyone, will begin at 10 o'clock. And the Lord's been speaking to me about what to talk about next Sunday, so I'm excited. I do have a word for you. Last week, I walked off the stage, and I was just talking to a few people that were here, and just undoubtedly, this season that we're in is unlike anything you and I have ever experienced. This Palm Sunday and next Easter Sunday is unlike anything we have ever experienced in our lives. It's a very surreal experience that one week we have normal church attendance as usual, and then the very next Sunday, it's just me and the media team and the worship team and the sound guys here. Very strange, but I've had a few people, I want to play a video for you, what I'm hoping the first Sunday back will be like. And I've had a few people post this on my wall on Facebook, so if you would, go ahead and roll that video. Ha ha ha. All right. That's what I'm anticipating. I'm anticipating coming here and celebrating with you guys. What I'm hoping that it is, I hope that it's not like a taper back. It could be a taper back. I'm hoping it's like we're all here one Sunday. Who knows how long this is going to go, but we're doing the best we can with the season that we're in. Undoubtedly, this season that we're currently in will mark our culture and our world really forever. We're all looking for kind of normalcy to return to our lives, of course. We want things to return to normal. But this season will mark us forever. If you look throughout our history, for example, people who were raised and they were in the Great Depression. I have a great-grandma who was raised through the Great Depression. Her mentality, it was marked by that forever. She's been very frugal her whole life. The World War II generation, these are people who worked very hard and appreciated freedom. People who were raised and lived through the Cold War and the space race. Those of us who experienced 9/11, those events marked us. Even though things kind of returned to normal, those events definitely mark us. And this is no different. Obviously, this, in case you didn't know, this event that we're going through right now will mark us as a society and a culture for the long term. In 2007, 2009, we had what was called the Great Recession. Our economy took a plummet there for a little while. And, you know, we talk a lot about the millennial generation. And one thing that bothers me is people are confusing, by the way, Gen Zers with the millennials. I saw, you know, pictures of people on beaches during spring break, and people are like, oh, look at these millennials. They're ruining it. You know, they're spreading this disease. By the way, those are not millennials. Millennials are like 30 years old. So stop calling people that are in college millennials. Millennials are like 30. Gen Zers are in college right now. But what I want to say about Gen Zers is they were marked, many of them, by the Great Recession, 2007, 2009. Why? They saw their parents struggle. Many of them saw their parents struggle. As a result, unlike previous generations, Gen Zers are more likely to save money. They're more likely to want jobs with benefits. They're more likely to look for stability. That season marked them as a generation for years to come. I'm not sure exactly how this season will mark us long term, but undoubtedly it will. Okay, for example, every election from now on, at the state level all the way up to the highest office, they're going to talk about pandemic readiness. Undoubtedly, it's going to mark us forever. The title of my message today is, so we're talking about shift. We're talking about change. The title of my message today is called Ready to Shift. Look at the person sitting next to you in your living room and say, get ready to shift. I can't hear you say it, but I believe you did, okay? Shift is a nice way to say change. Get ready for change. We're looking for normalcy. We're looking for things to go back the way they were, but things are going to shift, and not just for the bad. I think things can shift and will shift for the good, and I believe things can and will shift for the kingdom of God. Amen? Okay. Before I go any further, I want to just say I thought of a less appropriate title for this message, which is Shift Happens. But I didn't call it Shift Happens. I got a laugh in the room. Good. Okay. I won't give you the other title I thought of. I was going to say it. I'm not. You can text me if you have my number. Okay. So things are changing, and I want to talk to you today about navigating change, okay? Navigating change. Things are changing. Many people would say of themselves that they don't like change. In fact, if you interview most people would say of themselves that they don't like change. But actually, I want to say, I don't know if that's completely true. What I believe people really don't like is something that Harmony mentioned a few moments ago when she was up here on the stage. I think people don't like the feeling of not being in control. The loss of control is really what people don't like. Let me prove it to you. For example, if you're a single person and you want to be married, you're single, you want to be married, you meet a new person that you're really excited about. Most single people, when they meet someone they're excited about, would be excited about the change of dating a new person and the prospect of possibly marrying someone that, you know, they could spend the rest of their life with, okay? That's a change that they would welcome, okay? Contrast that. If I came to you and I said, this person, you're going to marry this person. This is an arranged marriage. Even if that was the right person for you, you would still probably be like, well, wait a minute. Maybe I don't want to marry that person, right? Let me give you another example. If you landed your dream job, you would most definitely welcome that change, wouldn't you? If those of you who aren't in your dream job, your dream vocation, if you landed your dream vocation, you would welcome that change into your life. That's change, isn't it? But you would welcome it. Contrast that with this. I said, hey, here's your new job. You're going to do this for the rest of your life. Even if that was the perfect job for you for the rest of your life, you would probably be like, well, I don't know if I want that job. I don't know if that's the perfect job for me. Why? Because you didn't choose it. You weren't in control over it, right? Last example. If I handed you the keys to your dream home, most people would welcome that change. That would be a change for you, wouldn't it? But if I came to you and said, hey, you're going to live in this house for the rest of your life. You're going to love it. You're going to live here. Even if that was the perfect house for you, you would probably resist the idea of having to live there because someone made you. Why? Because you're not in control. My point is this. Probably more than not liking change, you don't like the feeling of not being in control of your lives. We welcome change if it's good and if we feel like we're at the reins. How many know that we're in a season where we don't feel like we're at the reins? It kind of feels like, oh, it's out of control. I can't control this. I certainly didn't choose this. I didn't choose to speak to a room of empty seats and all of you sitting in your homes, right? So there's good reasons that we try to empower people to feel like they're in control of their lives when we're making decisions. For example, as a team, some leadership models, there's kind of this top-down, hardcore leadership. Here at City Lights Church, of course, you know, I'm the lead pastor. My wife is the associate lead pastor. Of course, we make decisions top-down, but we actually try to have more of a team approach. Why? One of the reasons for that is people tend to resist what happens to them, but they tend to participate in what the decisions they helped to create. So that's why one of the reasons why we try to have a team approach here at the church is we want people to have that sense of buy-in because there's a sense of that they have some control in the situation. But here's the thing. It's the loss of control that most people have a hard time dealing with. But here's the thing. What makes us think that we're in control of our lives anyway, right? And to an extent we are, and to an extent we're not. Those are kind of the things we're balancing. The things that we can control, the things we can't control. Personally, I'm all about personal responsibility and making this life the best that I can. In fact, I think one of the worst traits is powerless people who are constantly blaming someone else for the situation that they're in. And listen, even if that's partially true, even if the situation you're in is because of someone else, even if that's partially true, number one, it's probably less true than you think, but number two, it's also not beneficial to say that all the time and to blame someone else for all your problems. Taking responsibility for your life is very important. So I'm all about responsibility, I'm all about innovation, but there are certain things in this world we just have no control over, unfortunately, things that are out of our control. There's this prayer, I'm not for written formula prayers, but there's this prayer I actually kind of like. It's called the Serenity Prayer. And it says this, God, grant me serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. Okay? We have to be content with the things that we can't change. We have to have courage to change the things we can, and we have to have wisdom to know which ones to actually spend time on, which ones can we control. Okay? But if you think about it in your life, there's so many things you have absolutely no control over. Number one, where you were born. We didn't choose where we were born, right? I didn't choose to be born in Denver, Colorado. To who you were born. We didn't get to choose our parents, right? That was chosen for us. We didn't get to pick, number three, the socioeconomic status to which we were born and raised into. And those three factors that I just mentioned there actually have a huge, they play a huge role in the trajectory of someone's life. Where you're born, to who you're born, and the socioeconomic status to which you were born. Okay? We have no control over those things. In our own life, we all make plans. We all try to plan our lives the best we can. Last year, my wife and I were like, 2019, it's going to be the year. It's going to be a good one. You know, we planted a church in 2018, and we're trying to kind of get in our groove, you know. 2019, we're like, this is going to be the year. We're going to do some great things. And then in March of 2019, we got rear-ended. Our car flipped over in the median. My wife broke her neck. Ben Miller, our youth pastor, was also injured. We were all injured, actually. It derailed our entire year. Like, everything I had planned, everything I'd hoped for that year pretty much got derailed, okay? So then this year, we're like, okay, 2020 is coming. I'm going to grab my schedule by the horns, right? My personal schedule, my church schedule. And so what did we do? We got all of our staff together, and we got a 2020 calendar, you know, a big one. And we went through every month, every week. And we planned every Sunday. I planned all the Sundays I'm going to preach. I planned all the guest speakers I'm going to have. We planned all of our events, right? And then I took another calendar, another big one. I put it down, and I planned my personal calendar for the year. And I planned all my vacations. And I was like, I'm going to do races here, and I'm going to climb mountains here, and this and that. In fact, I have an example. Go ahead and put up. There's a picture, if you would. So this is the one we did as a staff for the church. But all of a sudden, here we are, March, April. What in the world? What the heck happened here, right? Okay, it got completely shot. So right now it's completely shot because of our plans, everything we planned now, Good Friday, Easter, we had plans for Easter. It's completely shot. Okay, listen, plans are good, but here's the thing. Plans usually don't go as planned. I want to encourage you, plan your life, make plans. Plans are good, but plans rarely go as planned, okay? What do? We take responsibility for what we can. We trust God with what we cannot control. Amen? I want to talk to you today about three truths about change. We're talking about shift. We're talking about change, how to navigate change. Three truths about change. Truth number one, change is inevitable. Change is the inevitability of life. The world we live in is a dynamic environment. In fact, this is kind of a piece of nerdy fact. But if I put you in a time machine and we moved you forward 100 years and there were no clocks, how would you know you went forward in time? The only way you would really know or be able to measure that is by things would be different. Things would be in different locations. Things would change. In fact, that is a product of moving through time, the arrow of time, which only goes one direction. A product of that is things change. Things are in a constant state of change and decay, and this world changes around us. It's a dynamic environment. Change is inevitable. But listen, if you live in Colorado and you don't like the weather, wait 5 minutes, right? And it'll change. If you don't like who's in office or whatever, the president, wait 4 years or eight at the most, right? Because why? It'll change anyway. Even dictators over in different countries, eventually they're not going to be in power anymore. Things change. These great leaders we read out in the Bible, they had a season. Things change. God constantly, he's not changing, but the world that we live in is changing, okay? But listen, many times it's God who initiates change in our life. I'm not saying that God's causing a disaster or a calamity in our world by any means, but many times it is God who does initiate change in our life. And he does this out of his love for you because he's not content to leave you where you're at. He doesn't want you to stagnate. He wants you to continue growing, right? And Hebrews chapter 12, it says that everything that can be shaken will be shaken. Eventually, everything that can be shaken will be shaken. Why would God do that? So that the things that cannot be shaken will remain. It says that we're receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Okay? But in the interim, in this current dispensation of our lives, God many times, out of his love for you, will shake things that you have, your foundation is on those things. He is happy and glad to shake those things. Just like if you had children and they're trusting in things that they shouldn't trust in. Man, if you're standing on a false foundation, it is out of love that God would shake something in your life. It's out of his love and his grace for you that he will shake something like that. Why? Because he wants us to rely on him. He wants our foundation to be firmly established on him. So he'll shake anything and everything that you're trusting in. It's not wrong to have things. It's wrong for things to have you, right? If you're trusting in things, you're trusting in stuff, or you're trusting in wealth, God is happy to shake those things out of his love and devotion for you to get you to ultimately rely on him. Okay? So many times it's God that's actually doing it. So change is inevitable. Point number two, change can also happen suddenly. All right? Today is Palm Sunday. I'm going to read a portion of scripture that just talks about Palm Sunday to kind of illustrate this. By the way, parents, if you want to teach your kids about Palm Sunday, read Matthew 21, verses 1 through 11, and then go back to Zechariah and read the prophecy that it fulfilled to just teach your children what was happening today. Let's read verse 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord has need of them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle, riding on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds went ahead of him, and those followed shouted, "Hosanna, Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Okay, this is the picture of Jesus' triumphal entry, prophesied by Zechariah, you know, years before this happened, hundreds of years before this happened. This is the triumphal entry of Jesus, the king, coming into Jerusalem. It's today. It's Palm Sunday, right? That happened. But what happened five days later? This is what's known as Good Friday. Jesus is on trial before Pilate. Pilate asks, "What shall I do with this Jesus, who's called the Messiah?" And the Bible says they all shouted, "Crucify him." They all shouted. So what Sunday, they're laying palm branches, "Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." 5 days later, "Crucify him." Like, that's how fast things can change in this life. That's how finicky people are sometimes. That's how finicky cultures and societies can be, okay? Political environments can be like that, so finicky. Things in our life are like that. They can flip so fast, so easy. I think it was David, it says this in the Bible, I think it was David says that life is but a vapor. It's here 1 second and it's gone. Listen, I'm all about the kingdom of God coming to this earth. I'm all about making this earth a better place. But we need to also live in view of eternity. One of the things that we, going through the season especially, we need to live in view of eternity. Amen? Okay, so what you think is stable today can be flipped on its head tomorrow. Be careful what you have your faith and trust in, okay? Change can happen suddenly. Okay, change is inevitable. Change can happen suddenly. But point number three, change often comes with a silver lining. Okay, that's maybe the one good news of my 3 points. Change often comes with a silver lining. I don't want to make light of the situation we're in as a country and in the world. There are people who are very sick or afraid of getting sick. There are people who are afraid of losing their jobs or have lost their jobs. There's a lot of negative things. I don't want to make light of any of that. But many times through a tragedy, there ends up being many good things that come about. One example of this would be maybe World War II, one of the most terrible things that ever happened in the history of the world. But part of the reason why Israel was birthed as a nation, a good thing that happened, is because of World War II. It was like the birthplace for the country of Israel, one of the things. Okay, another example of this would be last year. I mentioned my wife and I got rear-ended. My wife broke her neck. It was terrible, very scary time for us. And then they did an MRI on her body, scanned her whole body. They found 2 nodules on her thyroid. After getting those biopsied, we learned that my wife had thyroid cancer. And then she had surgery, half of her thyroid's removed, and today she's cancer-free, 100% cancer-free. Well, listen, that was kind of the silver lining of that whole event. I'm not saying that God caused the accident, but the silver lining through that accident was that we found that my wife had cancer in her body. Listen, what had happened if, instead of we found that in 2019, what if it was 2029, 10 years later? It could have been much worse. The situation could have been way worse. When we found that out. So thank God we found out when we did, and when it was so new to her body, we were able to get rid of it. That was a silver lining. Many times there's a silver lining through the things we're going through. I want to give you a list. I made a list of silver linings through this season. Here's a list of them, and you can come up with your own list as well. Number 1, we will be much more pandemic ready as a country, as a world. We will be much more pandemic ready. We will stockpile essential goods, life-saving medicines, and personal protective equipment. Number two, science and medicine are going to take leaps forward. Number three, cooperation between governments to mitigate disease will increase drastically. Number four, people will be more prone to save money. Most Americans live paycheck to paycheck. More Americans will be prone to save money. Number five, people will be more prone to eliminate more of their debt. Number six, people will be more prone to keep reserves of essentials in their homes. Can I get an amen for anyone who's ran out of toilet paper, right? By the way, we don't have like true shortages. If we're running out of toilet paper, we're fine. Okay, I haven't seen any food shortages. Number seven, many parents will either appreciate their kids' schools or realize they have what it takes to homeschool. So you might be learning, hey, I have what it takes. Or you're like, praise God for their teachers in their school. Okay. Number eight, people will be more conscious about spreading germs. That's a good thing. Wash their hands more. Be careful. Number nine, many companies will realize that they can accomplish a lot more through video conferencing, and a lot more people will be able to work from home. This will save on travel expenses and wear and tear on vehicles, gas, and commuting time. Number 10, many people will lose their jobs and have lost their jobs, but it'll actually propel them to go after their dreams. Number 11, churches are learning to be more creative to reach their congregations. Number 12, the United States is likely to begin producing more essential medicines that are currently manufactured overseas, which will make us less dependent on foreign countries. Number 13, our borders are likely to become more secure, slowing the spread of illegal narcotics, human trafficking, etc. Number 14, people will stop taking for granted things like traveling freely, going to church, and being around crowds in general, right? I think people will be more grateful in general, because there's certain things we take for granted. We're just going to be more grateful. Sometimes going through hard things makes you a more grateful person. Number 14, people will be more likely to get in shape and stay in shape as to exist pre-existing conditions that make them vulnerable. Number 15, people are likely to realize that even though the stock market is finicky, that their happiness does not hinge on their 401k, right? God will shake everything that can be shaken. Number 16, most people are more likely to appreciate the elderly and the more vulnerable members of society. 17, many people will realize that having a struggle will actually make them stronger and they will be less entitled. 18, many people are getting much needed rest by staying at home. I've actually heard a lot of people say, I'm actually really enjoying this, like, stay-at-home orders and stuff. They're getting much-needed rest, especially you introverts out there. You guys are eating this up right now. Us extroverts, we're going a little crazy. Pray for us. Pray for your pastor. Number 19, many people are reconnecting with family members that they were too busy for in the past. And last one, number 20, people are asking more questions about faith and eternity, and more people are placing their faith and trust in Jesus or rededicating their lives to the Lord. Those are some silver linings that I can see going through this tragedy. It's a tragedy. So my question for you this morning is this. What is the silver lining for you? Yes, it's an inconvenience. Yes, it's actually tragic in many ways. The loss of life is, of course, the most tragic. But what is the silver lining for you going through this? Maybe this season will give you the excuse you need to change the things you need to change, to be the person you want to be, or to have the relationship with God that you've always wanted to have. Okay, what's the silver lining for you? Change is inevitable. Change can happen suddenly, but oftentimes change comes with a silver lining. I just want to say to you, we are going to be okay, and we are going to get through this. Things will normalize. Undoubtedly, our culture will be marked forever, and we will always look back on this very strange time, because things are shifting. As I close, I want to pray for a specific group, and then I think Harmony's going to come up here at the end and do a call to salvation. But I want to pray for a specific group, and that's those of you, more than the concern about getting the virus, more of you are concerned probably with the economic implications of what's happening right now. Many of you are wondering if you are going to be laid off or have been laid off. Many of you business owners are facing, who do I lay off, and are facing those very tough decisions. And I recognize that those are very difficult things and very stressful things on you. I just want to say we are going to get through this. You are going to get through this, and we are going to be better off in the end. But I want to pray for you as I close and just pray for this situation. So if you would, Father, we love you. We thank you, Jesus. You're amazing. We thank you, God. This didn't blindside you. You are the unchanged one. You are the Father of lights in whom there is no variation or shadow of churning. You are steady. In some regards, God, you're even predictable in some ways because you're a steady, consistent, faithful Father. And we thank you and honor you for that, Lord God. You're good, and you have good plans for each of us, each of our lives, Lord. I bless every person right now who's under pressure, under stress, either from fear of getting sick, but also the economic stress of losing a job, losing finances, or making difficult decisions about laying people off. I bless them, and I pronounce wisdom over you in Jesus' name. Wisdom and grace to endure this season, to go through it, and not just to survive, but to thrive in Jesus' name. We thank you that your bride, the church, is here on earth to be a shining example to the world of what the Father looks like, of what the Son looks like. So Holy Spirit, we just bless you. We welcome you into our homes, Lord. And we just thank you for everything you're doing in our life. We love you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
We're gonna wrap up, but I wanted to read something to you guys real quick. These are the words of Jesus, and it's in the Passion Translation. And it says, are you weary, carrying a heavy burden, then come to me and I will refresh your life, for I am your oasis. Simply join your life with mine, learn my ways, and you'll discover that I am gentle, humble, and easy to please. You will find refreshment and rest in me, for all that I require of you will be pleasant and easy to bear. And that's for every single one of us, but specifically for those of you out there who have walked away, haven't connected with Jesus, have never given your life to him. He's just saying, come. Come to me. Let me take that burden off of you, that weight of sin, that heaviness, that thing that keeps you bogged down. Because that's why he came, was to release us, every one of us, from that weight, from that burden of sin that separates us from God, that doesn't allow us to have the full peace and the joy in his promises. Jesus died for us to change everything and to set us free because he loves us. So if there is any of you out there who say, yeah, that's me, I want that, we're just gonna pray right now, and then we're gonna go into a time of worship. But you can just, yeah, join me in praying, but saying, Jesus, we need you. Jesus, I need you. I choose today to make you the Lord of my life and move, repent from the sins, and give you that burden, that heaviness, that thing that separates me from you, separates me from your joy and your peace. And I choose to receive your salvation and your kingdom right now. If you prayed that with us today, please let us know. We want to be praying for you and welcome. Your life might not change outwardly right away, but inwardly, you are going to have peace. And that weight that you've been under is going to be removed because that's his promise for us. And so we just bless you right now in the name of Jesus and say, welcome. Welcome to salvation.
Let's just sing the chorus of this song one last time. Or the bridge, the may his favor. May his favor be upon you for 1,000 generations, on your family and your children. Their children, the children, may his favor be upon you for 1,000 generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, may his favor be upon you for 1,000 generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you
for a thousand generations on your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you for a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you for a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you for a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you for a thousand generations on your family and your children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He's for you, he's for you.
Jesus. We love you, Lord. Thank you for such a beautiful time together. Thank you for your presence, God. Thank you for filling every heart and every home with your love, with your favor, with your courage, God. Thank you. That perfect love drives out fear. So we just thank you for the love of Jesus today. And I just pray for an anointing over parents with kids, that this would be a time of that impartation from generation to generation. I bless every household that the parents would begin to read the Bible with their kids if they haven't yet. They would get around and worship together and connect with God as a family in a new way. I just bless you to do that, to take authority in your own homes in this season. I just think there's such a grace on that because, guys, the future needs to know the ways of Jesus, and they're not going to just get it once a week at church, obviously. They need to get it daily from their homes and from their families, and kids can really understand the Bible more than you think they can, some of us, so just go for it. Ask the Lord to help you with that. I bless you. Couple of closing just reminders. If you need help in any way, get a hold of us by email. You just email outreach@citylights.church. We have a whole team of people that would love to bless you, minister to you in any way that we can. We can't do everything, but we can do something. And we want to be a family to you. Just a reminder, for Easter next Sunday, we're going to start with a kids service at 9:45 on this exact same channel. So you just go to our YouTube Live. We'll begin our kids service just for City Lights kids starting at 9:45. And then we'll have our normal Sunday morning service for Easter to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus at 10 a.m. on Sunday. We bless you. We hope you have a wonderful week. Just remember to have your communion elements ready as you join us every week. We'll take communion together. All right. God bless you. We will see you on Resurrection Sunday.